So I record this PowerPoint for your purpose. So amphibia metamorphosis, we have already seen during the early development of the frogs, particularly during the gastrulation, the fertilization process, when we discussed about the development of the frog. We have discussed the life cycle of the frog, so you know that. So we will start from the concept of metamorphosis. We know that insects and some of the amphibians undergo dramatic changes in their life cycle. The process is called as metamorphosis, where the entire complete reorganization of their body plans is happening, suiting them to the more of a terrestrial life than the aquatic life. We know that the frog fertilizes externally in the aquatic bodies, and the larval stage is completed in the water, freshwater environment. But the adult has to live in the terrestrial environment. So for that, they have to change entirely almost all the structures that originally it possess. That process is called as metamorphosis. Probably some of you might have remember the story of that I mentioned, the Kafka's metamorphosis story. There is an author called Francis Kafka. So he has written a story about this metamorphosis, where a human being will be changed into an insect, and how the family deals with that. That is about the story. But now we'll come to the subject here, where first thing, how they have started is, like, as I told you, right, the experimental biology started with the developmental biology, actually. So what they did is, they have taken the tadpole. They think that tadpole can serve as a wonderful model for studying the development and the other related processes. So what they did is, they take the tadpole and they take different organs from animals. For example, they take a calf and they dissected their body. Each organ, they'll take it, and they separately feed the tadpoles with the separate organs. For example, some of the tadpoles are fed with only thyroids. Some of the tadpoles are fed with only liver. Some of them fed with adrenaline. To understand what these individual organ systems are capable of doing, or how they influence the growth and the development. So you can see that, right? From a dog, cat, all the organs, you can use the horse, even the calf, they have taken. And when they treated with those tadpoles that are treated with the thyroid, shows a remarkable growth compared to the other organ-fed tadpoles. So this make them understand that then some of the compounds or the materials that are present in the thyroid are capable of inducing growth. So the thyroid hormone is the first morphogen that has ever been discovered. So after that, this thyroid also induces the two hormones, the thyroxine and the triiodothyronine. So T4 and 3T. So probably you know that these three, TH, TSH, T3, T4, still very actively studied enzymes, and maintaining a homeostasis of this kind of this enzymes is very much important for the proper developmental growth, even in the adult humans. So probably if you are obese, probably you'll be asked to check the thyroid. If you're not growing properly, you'll be again asked to check the thyroid. So thyroid is again a very, very important hormone. We know it now. This is how they discovered the thyroid hormone in the beginning. So what happens? So when the So these three hormones, when they are secreted, right? So the larva, internal organs of the larva, they respond to the enzymes in any of the four ways. So some of the tissues will start growing. Opposite to that, some of them are dying. Some tissues remodel themselves. That means they change their morphology and functions. And some of them re-specify. The re-specification, we know that, right? But the specification, we have studied extensively. So the same hormone, thyroid, these thyroid hormones, right, can bring about different responses from different organs or tissues that are present inside the larva. So before we move into that, we'll just see the life cycle to recapture what we have already studied. You can see that an adult frog lays eggs, it becomes embryo, and we have a tadpole. Tadpoles with the hind limbs. Remember the video that I have shown in the classes. And you can see the four limbs also, and with the tail bud, and finally an adult. Okay. So the process of this tadpole transforming into this adult is what you call this metamorphosis. And you can see that the same time you can see the size of the thyroid gland. Okay, from a very, very incipient size, okay, you can see the very, very prominent increase in the expression of the thyroid hormone in the tadpole. You can see the head, and you can see they have stained the thyroid hormone there in the animal itself. You can see how much concentration is getting increased as the tadpole begin to grow. You can see that. So this clearly shows that thyroid gland function is essential and important for the transformation from a larval stage to an adult, the process of metamorphosis. So if you are a student, you have several interesting questions you can ask with the amphibian metamorphosis process, because you can see one single hormone control several developmental programs. We have seen in the previous four units, right? Each and every organ system, cellular system, tissues have very, very well programmed programmed protocols they should follow to develop into a proper organ or tissues. But we can see an interplay of several genes, right? We have seen the gradients are formed. We are seeing one inhibiting the other, one inducing the other, how the patterns are getting formed. But it seems that this one enzyme can influence multitude of developmental programs. So how it is possible? That is one interesting question, because you know it's kind of a universal kind of enzyme. Second, same enzyme bring about different responses in different tissues. For example, the tail muscle, what happens if the presence of thyroid hormone, they'll die. Whereas the limb started to grow. Exactly opposite. You know, the tails and the hind legs are going to be very close by. But these two different tissue types respond to the thyroid hormone. One begin to grow, other begin to die. Again, it's an interesting question. And you can see they autonomously respond to the thyroid hormones. Most of the time we have seen the gene expression systems and the gene regulation systems. It is not one particular enzyme. The entire tissue has to respond properly, which is dependent upon several other clues. But this particular enzyme, all organs respond autonomously to the thyroxine hormone. So that is again an interesting thing. So it's like how this one particular enzyme bring about all these changes is a puzzle, and we are slowly getting answers for these questions. That's what we'll be seeing in the next few slides. So before we go into that, what are the morphological changes that are associated with the metamorphosis? So we have seen the thyroid hormones T3 and T4, right? Collectively called the TH, right? They are the one, they initiate the process of metamorphosis. So what they do is some of the new structures are getting formed by the thyroid hormones. The major two things are the hind legs and the eye. Okay. So you can see the presence of thyroid hormones initiate the formation of the legs by limb muscles. Also they induce new neurons, not remodulating of the neurons. New neurons are getting formed in the presence of the thyroid hormones. So three structures, one is the limbs, neurons, eyes and eyelids. So probably anyone can tell me what is a nictitating membrane?
But instead of going vertically, it closes horizontally. Yeah, and in yes. Humans, it's a skin organ.
Yeah, it's an eyelid. It's not an eyelid, but it is a membrane that covers the eye that goes from the bottom to the head region. That's good. Okay, so this nictitating membrane, eyelids, eyes, limbs, and the neurons are the new structures that are getting created in the presence of your thyroid hormones. Second one is the death of the cells, the opposite to the what we are studying in the previous slide. There are organs that are getting reabsorbed by the process of apoptosis and the cell death. Okay, so what happens? The tail and gills. Okay, so these two structures are very important for the larva. We know that because the larva has to swim. We have seen this is a very active stage in their life. They constantly eating. They look for food always. So the tail and the gills. Gills is important because they are living in the water. So it has to breathe. So the respiration happens through the gills. So these two, tail and gills, which are not required for an adult. Okay. So they get reabsorbed. Okay, through the process of cell death. So first part of the tail reserve is suicide. That means that the cells undergo apoptosis. Then as the development progress, you have to speed up the process, right? So they initiate the cell death. Later, this developing adult secrete macrophages that will completely eat the tail and gill cells. So the initiation is apoptosis followed by the macrophagy. Then RBCs. So changing from the aquatic to the terrestrial environment also require the change in the RBCs. So the tadpole RBCs are again digested by the macrophages that are present in the liver and the spleen. So your hemoglobin that is present in the RBC will be replaced by a different version of the hemoglobin that will bind to the oxygen slowly and releases it more rapidly. So initially it will be like fast binding and fast release because the water has to diffuse through. Since you have a dedicated lung, so this will help the breathing easier with the help of your lungs. So So the old structures, the new structures are going to be the lymph, islets, nictitating membrane, lungs, limbus, all these things. And the cell death is through the macrophagy and the apoptosis. That you can see in the tail muscles, RBCs and the hemoglobins. So third thing that is happening is the remodeling. The existing structures getting remodeled. One is the new growth. Second one is the death of the cell. Third one is the remodeling process. Remodeling can happen. You can see the development of the lungs, disappearance of the kids. So we need lungs to breathe in the terrestrial environment. So lungs are getting formed. You can see the lower jaw transformation. So the lower jaw transformation is like more from a fish-like structure. The jaw will transform into a typical frog-like structures with a strong mandible. Okay, so to suit their food appetite. And the third thing is the long spiral gut. You know that herbivores, since the digestion of the vegetarian food is very difficult because of the presence of the metabolites, secondary metabolites and cellulose, typically vertebrates, your herbivores will have a very, very long gut, which is required for the long process of the food digestion. So that will be replaced by the short carnivorous gut. Carnivores eat meat, the readily it will get digested. So you don't need a long gut. So that also you can see because frog eats mostly the insects. So this change is also observed. Then the nervous systems adapted for hearing and stereoscopic vision. So initially when the fish is, the tadpole is inside the water, it behaves like a fish. So it doesn't require, the auditory system doesn't have to be perfect. But when you move to the terrestrial environment, your ears are very important. And the vision is also become stereoscopic. That means the normal higher animal visions, where you have two eyes give the inputs to the brain at the same time. To understand the left and right. So that kind of stereoscopic vision is created. Third one is the eyes. You can see probably this is not the correct picture. You can see that slowly the eyes are getting repositioned. You can look at the eye here, right? This will tell you. You can see rather than a fish-like structures, you can see that they become more prominent and it is at the top of the head. To use that in the terrestrial environment. You can see the change in the eye. You can see. So eyes are repositioned and eardrum, middle ear, inner ear to hearing. Skin become thicker and tougher to suit the terrestrial environment, keeping them moisture. So lungs, jaw, head, nervous system, gut, eyes, eardrum, skin, everything is remodel. So third step is the remodeling. One is the growth, cell death, remodeling. The final one is the biochemical changes that you will observe that is happening inside the system. So you can see the pigment in the eye is the porphyropsin. So the porphyropsin is suited for the vision inside the water. But when it become adult, we produce the typical rhodopsin. The terrestrial and marine vertebrates, right? And the hemoglobin we have already discussed. Two important things happen in the body of the adult frog. One is the excretory system. The other one is going to be the liver enzymes. Okay. So, new habit, habitat, requires secretion of specific set of enzymes that is going to digest different kind of food. Also, the excretory system is changing from ammonotrophic to urotelic. That means ammonotelic, probably you know already, is excretion of ammonia. You know, the major waste that is produced in our body is the nitrogenous waste. So the nitrogenous waste can be removed in two ways. One is through the ammonia or through the urea. So we know that terrestrial animals prefer the urea elimination, whereas the aquatic animals uses the ammonia form of secretion. So why this is? Is because the removal of ammonia, removal of nitrogenous waste through ammonia require a lot of water. But terrestrial environment doesn't give you a lot of water. That is why there is a switch from ammonia release from to urea release. This is what we call as urotelic system. So the frog has to do that. It has to change from the ammonotelic to urotelic. Okay, so you can see the liver is the one that produces this enzymes that are required for the urea cycle, and slowly they will change from the ammonotelic to the urotelic. So other enzymes that are important for the metamorphosis is like, you know that all the enzymes are, hormones. All the hormones are secreted from the pituitary gland. We know that pituitary gland, TSH, adrenocorticotropin, thyroid stimulating hormones, thyroid. So all these things are produced. So finally, it interacts the thyroid. Thyroid produces the thyroid hormones, T3, T4. Okay, and the tadpole also influenced not only by the internal systems, even the photoperiod and the temperature pH plays an important role in influencing the secretion of the enzyme. So if you look at it, if you change the temperature of the water in which the tadpole is growing, you can see the change in the developmental process. So they'll respond to the environment, they'll respond to the pH, they'll respond to the temperature, and they'll respond to the photoperiodism, and how much light tadpole is getting. All this will influence the secretion of the pituitary gland hormones that in turn influence the developmental process. You can see a very minute four limb in this image. This entire tail is going to get reabsorbed. Okay, this portion will get reabsorbed. Here you can see the change in the heart and the gut. So this is like the enzymes that are present. Okay, the thyroxine is your T4 enzyme. So you have the triiodothyronine. So these two are the active form of enzyme. Comparatively, T3 is more active than the T2. Okay, so you can see that deiodinase, okay, removing the iodine, make the enzyme more active. Then if you remove one more iodine, it will become T2, so it will become inactive. And if you remove the iodine, its total iodine, it is going to be totally inactive. Tyrosine is your amino acid. Okay, so why this is happening is, like, if you can activate the T4 by removing one iodine, if you keep on removing the iodine, this enzyme, this hormone become inactive. Okay, the change in the hormone, okay, by removing the iodine happens during the post metamorphic process, because we cannot keep the tyrosine hormones active, because it will influence the growth very rapidly. So those hormones has to be inactivated, this inactivation of this thyroid hormones happens through removal of the iodine. You remember the structures? Probably somebody will ask which one is a particular form of enzyme, hormone. So this slide tells you the changes from the amenorrheic to urotelic transformation of the frog. You can see that the enzyme that are important for the urea cycle is the carbamoyl phosphate synthase, ornithine carbonate transferase, arginosuccinate, and arginosuccinate lyase. These four enzymes are very much important for the cycle, urea cycle. You can see they will produce the urea by incorporating the nitrogenous waste that are produced, the ornithine, all these things. So you can see the increase from a tadpole to the adult frog. You can see the very, very rapid increase of all the four enzymes. You can see a very high expression of these enzymes in the adult frog. You can see only tail but remains. I mean, now all the enzymes that are required for the urea cycle become active. So the excretion is through urea rather than the ammonia. You can see the increase in the enzymes. So there are three stages in metamorphosis. One is pre-metamorphosis. So this is corticosteroid receptor releasing hormone, produces the corticosterone, produces the pituitary, induces the pituitary, and produce the thyroid stimulating hormone, and they increase the expression of your T3. Okay, so tissue that respond earliest to the hormones. So D, we have seen that, right? D iodinase 2, that means the one that remove the iodine, actually they convert the T4 directly to T3. So the limb rudiments, okay? This is the very early stages. The very early stages, you can see the low level of T3 and T4. Even though those tissues that are capable of converting the T4 to T3 directly are active. Okay, so those tissues that require some stimulator for the conversion of T4 to T3 will be expressed in the pro-metamorphosis. The pre-metamorphosis, pro-metamorphosis. So pro-metamorphosis, the T4 increase is very dramatic. So tyrosine receptor on beta is very high increase. So what happens? This actually remove the second stage, move to the second stage of the metamorphosis. Okay, so the thyroxyreduction beta is a principal receptor. So it actually induces the metamorphic climax. So what happens is, never get rid of the tail before the legs are functional. But means that, so now the tails are not rapidly reabsorbed as long as the legs are fully developed. So even though some of the tissues that are not responsive to thyroid hormones also present, dorsal red, a few tissues that are not requiring, that are not involved in change in the lifestyle are not changed, those tissues are not responding to the presence of the hormone. Then what happens? Then the down regulation process happens. So it induces the negative feedback, cutting down the pituitary cells, causes the thyroid to secrete. So T3 is the one that inhibits the transcription. So the overall process is explained here. You can see the slowly there is a high increase, then it will come down as the organism develops from larva become adult. Okay. So the important things are the CRH, corticotropin releasing factor that induces the pituitary to produce the thyroid stimulating hormone, thyroid stimulating hormone produces thyroxine. T4 that can be converted into T3 through activation. This activation actually helps if the cells are capable of doing it themselves, will respond first and produces the dramatic changes. Those tissue that requires additional factor will respond to the thyroxine slowly. Then finally, when it reaches the climax, what happens is the negative feedback loops is getting operated, and this negative feedback actually prevent the expression of the production of the thyroid hormone, so that the adult have attained the homeostasis. You can see the important things are eardrums are developed, teeth is developed, skin are altered, keratin is strengthened, legs are formed, lungs are remodeled. Okay, these things are happening in the metamorphosis process. With that, we can complete the process of metamorphosis in the amphibians. So the next class we'll discuss about the metamorphosis that are present, that are happening in the insects. Okay, I'll stop here.